All right. Hello, everyone. How are we doing? Yes, no Nickelback today, unfortunately. This is a no Nickelback broadcast. Maybe, I don't know, maybe tomorrow. Maybe tomorrow. What are like some good songs for Nickelback? I don't know, small crowd. Kind of stinks, but whatever. I'm getting some faster internet. It's my new modem should be here shortly, so we're gonna get some faster internet, which will be a lot of fun. Make this a little bit smoother, it'll be a lot better. Anyways, we're gonna jump right back into the slides. Right now, so yesterday we talked about, you know, what a stock was, mutual funds were, bonds were. Now we're going to get into different types of retirement accounts. So let me jump in here real quick. I also ordered a new computer, so we wouldn't have this. That would help with the lag time as well. So retirement accounts. We're going to go over the 401k, the IRA, and the Roth IRA. But what does retirement fund actually involve? Okay, so I know that when I'm 60, I want to retire. I want to stop teaching. I need to plan for that, right? I'm not just going to rely on Social Security or, you know, some gift or whatever to get me through retirement. I need to plan for that, and I need to. When I'm young, I needed to set up, you know, a plan where I'm putting, you know, 15 bucks or 50 bucks a month into a retirement account, or 100 bucks a month, right? No matter how small it is, it will build up over time. And we're going to talk about three different types of accounts that will help you build those. And you're going to either defer tax for a little bit, or you're going to take the tax up front, you're going to pay the tax up front and then defer it later when you've made your money in that account. So first one we're going to go over is the 401k. So the 401k is an employer-sponsored retirement account that allows a percentage of your paycheck to be directly contributed. In some cases, employers will match what you contribute. That's free money. You're going to want to take that. Money is deposited before income taxes. So you only pay taxes once it is removed after retirement. I'm going to close my door here. All right. So what does that mean? Employer sponsored. So when I signed up to work for Monona Grove School District, they, or a different company, they will allow you to, they will allow you to get into the products that they found that they want to like help provide for your retirement, right? So I meet with the HR specialist and they say, listen, we have this group of retirement tools that you can invest in, and we will match up to 3% of your salary, up to 3% of what you put in. Okay, so what we'll do is let's say you make $100,000 and you put in $3,000 into this 401k, we're gonna match up to that. So we're gonna match up to $3,000, and which is great. That is like an extra $3,000 which you are being paid from the company. You wanna take that, you wanna leverage you wanna take advantage of that as much as possible. If you only put in $2,500, you're actually like, you're throwing away 500 bucks there, and you're not using that tool that was created for you. So no matter what you make, maximize what your employer will like give back to you As far as that type of incentive, even if you have to eat ramen noodles or whatever, like if you make $30,000 and they'll match up to 3%, take all of it. Fill up that bucket with your money so that you maximize what they're putting in as well. So this is also pre-tax dollars, all right? So if you make $100,000 and you put in $3,000, your taxable income now goes down to $97,000, okay? So instead of being taxed on the whole $100,000, you are now being taxed just on $97,000 of your earnings, okay, for your salary. Now, you'll have to pay taxes later, right? So when you take out the money, then you're going to have to pay taxes on that income later, all right? So you're going to have to pay taxes one way or the other. It's either at the beginning or at the end of, you know, this cycle for retirement, right? So let's go back to the slides here. Now, the IRA, an individual retirement account that is separate from an employer. Like a 401k, it contributes, the contributions and earnings are not taxed until they're withdrawn during retirement. Often used by small business owners and entrepreneurs. Okay, so you have to set this up by yourself. All right, so you have to walk into your bank or walk into your investment guy and say, I want to set up an IRA. Right, the 401k is employer sponsored on the assessments. 401k, employer sponsored. IRA. This is sponsored by you. You are setting this up. You have to be proactive to do that. All right, but what's neat about it is you don't have to pay taxes on this income. So this further reduces your taxable income. So let's say you put $3,000 in your 401k, and then you put in another $3,000 into your IRA. Your taxable income will then decrease by $6,000, another $3,000 down, right? So instead of being taxed on $100,000, you're reducing it down to $94,000, right? Another $3,000 down, you're now paying taxes based off of $94,000. And these are just tools. So if taxes are high right now, if payroll taxes are high right now, take advantage of this. But if payroll taxes are low and you think that taxes are going to be really high later, then maybe you want to do something else, right? Maybe you want to pay the taxes now and then invest that and not worry about paying taxes later on this money. And that's where you come into the Roth IRA. So the Roth IRA, like a normal IRA, is separate from the employer. Okay, again, this is all you. You have to walk into that business or that bank or that investment guy or jump on your Acorns app or whatever and then actually do your research and set up an IRA and or a Roth IRA. But unlike the 401k or the IRA, the money is taxed before you contribute to the account. So you're using after-tax dollars here. Delaying paying taxes on this money. It doesn't reduce your taxable income. You will actually pay taxes on this money. Then you will put that into a Roth IRA. But what's great is whatever you make in this afterwards, right? So you're using after-tax dollars and whatever you make on that, you're not going to have to pay taxes on that once you're done. You can also take out of your Roth IRA, you can also take out what you put in, but then you're going to have to pay taxes on it at that time. You can't take out your earnings, though. All right, so let's say you take out a loan. What's a loan? A loan is the act of giving money. Property or other material goods to another party in exchange for future repayment of the principal amount along with interest or other finance charges. This can come from individuals, corporations, financial institutions, or governments. All right, so that's what are we doing with bonds? We're giving the issuer a loan, right? So they will pay us back the principal plus the interest at a specific time. All right, just like if you go get a car loan, they're loaning you money to buy an asset, to buy a car. So you will then pay money on that, or you will then pay interest. You're going to pay the principal back, and it's set up on a schedule of repayment. So a little review of what's principal. That's the original sum of money borrowed in the loan. What is interest? Interest is the additional charge cost for that privilege of borrowing money, usually expressed as a percentage or an interest rate. Sometimes people say points, right? Points are just interest rates. So if I say I'm going to pay 2 points on this loan, I'm going to pay 2% on this loan. That's how banks and investors make money. I could loan out, you know, if one of you guys came up to me and said, I need to borrow $100. Well, I'll loan you $100, but I'm going to want some interest on that. And we decide how much interest I'm going to charge and at what, when will it become due? What are your payments? Is it going to be amortized over a year? Is it going to be amortized over 30 years? How long will it take you? And the longer it's amortized for, the more interest I'm going to make on that, the more money I'm going to make on it. So there are two primary types of interest. There's simple interest and compound interest. I would probably write these down, okay? So simple interest. Interest that is calculated off of the principal or original amount of the loan or original investment. So that's just off the original amount. So if you borrow $1,000 from me, all right, then you will only pay interest on that original amount, all right? So every year we're going to calculate the interest off of $1,000. Year two comes along, $1,000, calculate the interest off that. We're going to calculate the interest at year three off of $1,000. Here's an example of that. So $10,000 at 5% interest for 3 years is $1,500, right? So your ending balance that you will have paid, you're going to pay the $10,000 back, but you're going to also pay another $1,500 back. That's simple interest, okay? It's pretty easy to calculate. That's usually not how it works, though, okay? So if you go get a car loan, if you go get a mortgage, you're going to pay compound interest, all right? This interest is calculated off the principal or original amount and the accumulated interest in previous periods. All right. Right here, you'll see the equation. All right. It's a little bit different. Write that down, and you notice that P is for principal, I is for interest, and N. So you're going to take what 1 plus the interest is to the nth power. So that's number of years, right? For that times the principal. So in this example, N is the number of years here. So we have $10,000 at $500. We're gonna charge you. So the original after year one, the original amount is $10,000, and you're gonna pay $500 in interest. So your closing balance at the end of year one will be $10,500. Year two, then we take $10,000 plus the $500, so $10,500. And that interest, you take 5% of that, and that interest will be $525. So that your closing balance at the end of that year will be $11,025. And if you go into year three, you're going to be paying interest off of $11,025. So that 5% of that is $551.25. So at the end, you're going to be paying your principal back, then $11,576.25. So your total interest that you'll be paying at the end of year three is $1,576.25. All right, so that's how interest on a loan is calculated. All right, let's go into two scenarios. All right, so this is Bob versus John. Bob is going to invest $2,000 into the stock market each year at a 5% return, okay? Some years it might be 4%, some years it might be 7%. Whatever it is, at the end of 40 years, it'll average out to about 5% a year, all right? So if we average all those percentages for how many years, it's going to be about a 5% return after every year. John is going to put $4,000, he's starting out with more, $4,000 into his savings account that earns about 0.05% interest, all right? It's not a lot of interest. After 40 years, who's going to have more money? Someone that invests $2,000 each year at a 5% return, or just John, who starts out with more and then puts in $4,000 each year, right? He's going to put in $4,000, a little bit more each year. Who's going to have more money? So John will end up with a reasonable, after 40 years, $165,649. Not bad, John. Not bad at all. All right? Bob will have $255,684. Bob is investing less, half of what John is doing every single year. He's putting in less into the stock market, okay? Now, right now, you look at the stock market, it's in shambles, right? Like, people are not having a good time. Those people have been investing for 40 years. It's going to come back, all right? We're going to come back from this. You're going to see blips, and I'm going to post a couple graphs on the classroom that will show you that during each recession, right? The tech bubble, then the housing bubble, then this, all these graphs will go down and come back up. Go down and come back up a little bit every single year. I'll show you, I'll post those graphs, all right? So even though Bob did have, but he invested in the stock market, he was an active, you can't just invest into the stock market. You actually have to be active in it to make sure you make that 5%. And that's a pretty good, investment return. You'd like to get up into the sevens, you know, 8 would be awesome. 10 would be like, you're absolutely killing it. Some people can do that. You have to be really active to do that. But 5, that's a reasonable amount, 5% interest. All right, let's look at another scenario here. All right, scenario B, Sarah, who's 17. You guys are 17, 18 years old. You are Sarah right now, okay? She's a high school senior. She starts investing $40 a month, all right? That's $480 a year into the stock market. And the stock market, she's active, so she's watching the stuff, so she's going to get about 7%, all right? So that's great. I suggest for my classes, $50 a month, okay? You can do that. You can go out and you can grind out $50 a month as a 17 or 18-year-old kid to put into something, whether it's a stock, a low-cost index fund, something like that. We'll talk more about those later if you want. You know, you could be active in stocks. Whatever it is, $50 a month, you can do it. If you do this right now, $50 a month, starting at 17 or 18 years old, oh my goodness, it's gonna be great. So versus Candace, who starts when she's 30, all right? Full-time job, she starts investing $200 a month. So she's doing, you know, over four times what Sarah's started at 17, but she's starting a little bit late. She's starting 13 years late, but she's grinding it out like $2,400 a year in the stock market at 7%. They're still getting 7% when they're 60 years old. So in 30 years, Candace will be 60 years old, and Sarah in 43 years, she'll be 60 years old. Who has more money? All right. Same percentage, same stock market. Sarah will have a little bit more, $20,000 more for just $40 a month for those 43 years. 43 years, right? Now imagine if you invested $100 a month, right? You start at $40 or $50 a month, and then when you get in your job, you grind out even more and you do $100 a month. And then until you're 25, right? And then when you're 25, you go to $150 a month. Then when you go to 30, you go to $200 a month. And then when you go to 35, you can do 400, $500 a month. You put that in there, these numbers just, like, they blow up. They blow up. And you want to start now, okay? Start now. Please, 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 please start now. Make it work, okay? Don't go to that one movie and that one dinner at Applebee's with your friends, okay? Just don't do that one time, and you'll have that $40. Scenario C, all right? Let's see what happens if they do the same thing, all right? And a lot, I'll be honest with you, a lot of my peers at 30 or at 40, right now, they can only do $40 a month because they haven't made those sacrifices. They didn't start training their body, training their spending habits when they were 17 years old. So just imagine, you're 30 years old and all you can do is $40 a month because that's all a lot of people can do. What do you think they have? Sarah, who started when she was 17, 13 years earlier, is going to have over double what Candace has. Like, that's just, this is just simple math. This is just like real easy numbers. You guys start now. Please start now. Look at the difference. If you start when you're 17 versus when you start when you're 30, that is a huge difference. Okay? That is, I don't even like, that's a game changer for a lot of people when they retire. All right, so simple versus compound interest. We looked at compound interest. You know, you made, if you give out loans, you made, you know, over 3 years, you made 76 more bucks with simple interest, $1,500. So you want to make sure if you're giving loans to friends and family, which you should kind of be careful about, make sure it's off of compound interest because that's what's going to happen if they go to any bank or any loan shark or whatever. It's going to be off of compound interest. What is capital? Okay, so write this down. This is a very important word. This is going to be on the test or an assessment. Capital is something that's used to generate wealth through investment. Okay, capital gains are the money that you earn from an investment. So, committing money or capital, with the exception of obtaining additional income, with additional income for profit, that's investing. An investor is an investor can earn money from an investment in different ways depending on how they invest. So, here, capital. All right. So, let me explain to you a little bit about what capital is here. All right. So, I want to start. I want to go buy a building. Okay. I'm gonna need something down. Okay. So if I want to build a building for $1 million, I am going to need capital. I'm going to need to put some skin in the game. Capital is skin in the game, all right? So let's say I go to a bank and I say, I need $1 million to do this project. I want to build this building. They're going to say, great, we'd love to loan you the $1 million, but you need to, you can do this project for $1 million, but you need to put up $100,000 or $200,000 of your own money. You need to come up with capital, with $100,000 or $200,000 of capital in order to do this project. Okay, that's skin in the game. They know now that I'm not gonna walk away from $100,000 or $200,000. All right, so if I put up, if I want to buy a car, all right, the bank will loan me money, but in order to do that, I'm gonna have to put down some of my own cash for capital and I'm gonna have to attach my car with it, right? My car is gonna be attached to this loan. My house on a mortgage. The mortgage is going, the house is gonna end up to be that piece of capital that is like attached to that. So if I walk away, I lose the initial money that I put in, all the money that I paid into it, plus that actual physical asset, right? That's capital. All right, so what is, we talked about investing a little bit, committing money or capital, with the exception, or with the expectation of obtaining an additional income or profit. I'm not going to put up my money if I'm not going to get something back for that. The rule is 72. The rule is 72. By dividing 72 by the annual rate of return, investors obtain a rough estimate of how many years it'll take for the initial investment to duplicate itself. All right, so you take 72 over, let's say you're getting 5%, So you would do 72 divided by 5. Not 72 divided by 0.05. It would be 72 divided by 5. And that equals the time for the investment to double. All right, so let's look at it this way here. So at 3%, if I do 72 divided by 3, I know that roughly it'll take 24 years for my initial investment of $10,000 to turn into $20,000 at 3%. And then it'll take another 24 years for that 20,000, let someone else manage it and whatever. You can make 3, 4, 5%, all right? But it's going to take you longer than if you're at 6%. So let's say we go from 3% to 6%, all right? That's double the percentage points, right? So instead of it taking 24 years to get 20,000, to make that initial investment $20,000, it only takes us 12 years. And if you go up to 12%, if you are really cranking it and you really grind it out and grind the numbers and stay active in your thing, at 12%, that $10,000 turns into $20,000 in 6 years. You have to be active to, you know, really, so that you don't end up in this 3 or 6 range. You can pump it up to 8, 9, 10, 12% if you really work hard and make sure you stay on top of it. That's the rule of 72. In these slides, you can take a look at some portfolios on age-based circumstances. We'll go over a few additional investments here, and then we'll do a little review. So other types of investments. You can do real estate, right? You could buy homes. So I'm a real estate broker, and yes, people say that buying a home is an investment. I like to stay away from that just because it's like your home is where you're going to live, right? And you, yes, you have to treat everything that you're attached to, that you put money into, as an investment. You have to be active in that. But I would really shy away from calling that an investment because it's not so much an investment as it is you have to live somewhere. You're going to have to pay either rent or a mortgage. So you might as well put that into something that you own marketable title to. So yes, your home purchase, treat it like an investment. Be active with it. Make sure you keep it up. Make sure you do make sure you pay your property taxes. Make sure you do maintenance. Okay, treat it like it's a job. All right, and then you, depending upon the market, either go up or it'll go down, right? When it's time for you to sell and move into something else, or it's time for you to sell and, you know, move into a retirement home or whatever it is, you got to treat home purchases like an investment. Okay, so you have to pay that though because you have to live somewhere, right? That's why I don't like it so much as an investment. A property or rental income, if you own a piece of property and someone else has to pay, whether it's a company in a commercial building or it's a someone is renting a piece of property from you to live, that's an investment, okay? You put capital down. You put $100,000 down to buy a $500,000 piece of property, and some business comes in there, and they do their business in order to pay your mortgage for you. That's an investment. You have put down capital to make income and to make money. That's a good investment. Vacant property. Sometimes vacant property is an investment as well. There might be land up north that your family has that maybe your great-grandfather bought for $10,000, you know, back in the 50s. And right now you could sell that for $100,000 or $200,000 to someone who wants hunting land or wants to develop it. That's an investment. You still have to do maintenance to it, right? You still have to pay the taxes, right? There are costs that go along with having vacant property, totally normal. But yes, you are holding something in the hopes that it's worth more, okay? Just like holding some gold, or, you know, I collect fancy vans or something like that, right? Like, that's an investment. Housing, farmland, apartments, shopping malls, those are long-term investments. These are all long-term. What you'll see at the end of this financial situation that we're going through right now is you're going to see an increase in people talking about flipping homes, right? And you can, yes, you can make, people are going to lose their homes and it's going to be terrible. And you can make some money by picking up homes for less and then selling, waiting, fixing them up, waiting, you know, a couple months and selling them back for more money. Yes, you can do that, okay? Just right now, they go up and they go down. So what, and real estate, since it's more expensive than just like an ounce of silver, you gotta look at it like a long-term investment. All right, next slide here. Other long-term investments like collectibles. All right, so if you go, let's jump to the next slide here. Collectibles, items of personal interest to collectibles. Baseball cards. Baseball cards are huge when I was growing up. We used to trade baseball cards. We used to get this monthly magazine every month to see what the price of the Ricky Henderson rookie card was or Barry Bonds rookie card. And we used to trade them with our friends like you guys traded Pokemon cards or whatever it is. Stamps, coins, art, antiques, other collectibles. Those are all long-term investments, all right? You got to treat those like long-term because, like everything, they're going to go up, they're going to go down. All those things are considered long-term. Other commodities such as corn, soybeans, wheat, salt, other crops. These are all like tangible things that you can actually hold in your hand. Like you can buy it. Gold, silver, platinum, and other precious metals. If you look at what gold has been doing, actually, let's go right now. I want to see something here. Let's go to goldseek.com. Let's see what the price of gold has done in the past day. So this is a live gold price right here. All right, so right now it's $1,609. Here we go. Here's a live gold spot right here. 24-hour gold. We're trading about 1601 right here. And let's look at our 5-day. All right. So our 5-day ownership in a corporation, right? Like that's fair. That's the definition. But it's a piece of paper, right? Like it's, you have no control over it. You can sell it whenever, but someone else is making decisions in a company that, or in a corporation that affects the price of this. Gold and even silver, if you look at the silver charts, we can look at that later. Let's see here, the dollar, you can see the dollar has been going up and down and all around. Has this all been for, yeah. You can take a look, go to goldseek.com and then click into these charts and you'll be able to see what's been happening to the dollar. To precious metals. Look at the 3-month. Okay, so we went up. So 3 months ago, they were pretty bullish on gold. And actually, $1,500 an ounce is pretty. That's decent. So then it went all the way up to $1,700. Then we got really good at that. And then, when the economy starts, if gold's going up, the economy doesn't, like, something's happening. It's not looking good, right? So then the economy is looking good and it kind of drops. It drops really hard. But now we're kind of in this little valley right here and you're going to start to see this gold thing kind of go up a little bit. If we look at another year here, you'll see that for a year, people have been kind of thinking the economy's like something's going to happen to the economy here for the last year. Right? More people are investing into it and the price is going up. Silver is awesome. Actually, silver is at a kind of a great price right now. Interesting. All right. So then, let's look here. All right. I'm just going to turn this over to, let me see if there are any questions here on this live streaming thing. All right, small crowd today. Student asked a really good question in our class about retirement funds. What happens when you quit your job or leave your job? Does your fund follow you to your new job? Absolutely. So you can actually move that 401k over. You can take hold of it and put it with the company, right? So that will follow you. You will get that. What does PLN stand for? Oh, Ethan. Change. So, yeah, I'll change that, Ethan. I will look at that, and then I will change the frame rates. And then also I'm getting faster internet. Right now it's shared internet with the rest of the 600 apartments in my, or, you know, 300 apartments in my complex. It's shared internet, and I actually ordered my own internet yesterday just so we could do this. So the lag rates, I will do this stuff that you put in there, Ethan, and I will make those changes. PLN, and what terms, Braden? Let me just take a look at what you're actually doing. Oh, PLN, the Polish currency. That's what that would stand for. All right, so let me go back to the review here. It's 37. We're just going to do a quick review. We'll be done at 10:45. Let me see here. 24 slides. All right, so Julie lends the federal government money as part of investment. The government will keep that money for 10 years, predetermined 10-year period. After 10 years, she gets all her money back. Emily, every 6 months, she'll get a coupon, cash payment of interest, right? The coupon is interest, worth 3% of the money she loaned. What is that? What did they buy? Or what did the federal government issue her? That's right, that's a bond. LeBron and Kendrick go to a professional money management firm. The firm allows them to buy 10 shares of an investment that contain a bunch of stocks, bonds, and other securities all bundled into one giant investment. So they own a part of that. They don't own those individual shares, but they own a part of that bucket, right? What is this most likely called? That is a mutual fund. Great job. Sheldon and Leonard are looking for a way to save money for retirement. Their friend Penny tells them about several ways in which they can put their money aside from their paycheck that they can invest in until retirement. Name an example. So you got the IRA, Roth IRA, and 401k. Claire and Phil are looking for a safe investment. They go to their bank. And they receive a promissory note. This note allows the bank to keep their $1,000 of their money for 2 years. After that maturity date, they will receive their money plus back the interest that they gained. What is that called? That is a CD. Winnie and Christopher are excited when they realize that 2 years after making an investment in a honey company, they will receive interest and not only on not only their original investment, but also the interest they earned in year one as well. What is that? What type of interest is that called? So they made a loan, and they're getting compound interest, all right? They did a compound interest loan. Dora and Boots own a successful safari company. They are looking to expand internationally and want to raise money to do so. When they first decide to go public, they offer a stock. What's the name of that first sale called? That is the IPO, initial public offering. Chris, Peter, Brian all buy shares in Dora and Boots Safari Company. The following year, the Safari Company makes bank. That's a lot of revenue, apparently. As a result, Chris and Peter and Brian are given additional shares of the company for free. What did they get? They got a dividend in the form of shares. All right. Guys, this is the end of the slides. Tomorrow, my plan is to go back here. All right, like, submit those and to Ms. Renz or I, and we'll go through that. After that, we're going to try to have a discussion on the inside job, so make sure that you watch that. We're going to go over a little bit of those key things. I'll have some comments for a lot of your essays that you've done. Thank you very much for all those that have done the essays. If you're waiting a little bit until I do this, like if you're working, guys, I understand that. All right. So, what is a sector? I just got a question. What is a sector? Okay. So a sector is like a part of the market, right? So, if you have the marketplace, right? We have retail, we have restaurants, we have manufacturing, we have travel and tourism, we have other things. So if I want to invest in, like, let's say I like airlines, we would be in the travel and tourism sector or the airline sector, right? That's what a sector is. Or if I want to, I really like certain brand name foods or whatever, I'm going to invest into like the food manufacturing sector. That's what a sector is. And sectors can be broken up into different things, different groups, right? Like, depending upon where you are geographically or whatever, sector is just a section of a total marketplace. That's what a sector is. Thank you very much for the question, Anna. Okay, so we're going to go through some more of those questions. And then also, we're going to take a look at... the inside job. I'll go over some of your comments. And then Thursday, what I'd like to do is everyone should do number three. We're going to post those up in Google Classroom. Everyone should have done number three for the the investing, like buying and selling stocks or whatever. So go over that. And then make sure you do that. You're going to do it online. And then we will, I'll go through each problem on my whiteboard and show you how to do those, all right, and answer some questions there. Once again, guys, I'm very proud of you. Thank you very much for those that logged in. Mr. Renz and I, Ms. Daines, we really appreciate you guys being involved and with it here. If you need anything from us, just let us know. You guys are, once again, we miss you. We wish that we were with you, but unfortunately, we all got to kind of buckle down here and get through this all together. I will talk to you guys later. Have a great day. Ethan, I'll go through these comments. I'll make those changes. Thanks, bud. Bye.